Welcome everyone to today's Early Bird Talk. My name is Misha and I work with Early Bird, which is a project under the Education and Public Engagement Program of Nature Conservation Foundation. We work towards creating and disseminating creative educational content to introduce people to birds. And today's guest speaker is Rohan Chakravarti, who's going to talk about his journey as a bird watcher. Now, notorious for rolling up into a ball like a pangolin to avoid meeting people, Rohan is a cartoonist, an illustrator, and the creator of Green Humor, which is a series of cartoons, comics, and illustrations on wildlife and nature conservation. Cartoons from Green Humor appear periodically in newspaper columns, magazines, and journals. Illustrations from Green Humor have been used for several projects and campaigns on wildlife awareness and conservation. Rohan has also authored two books, The Great Indian Nature Trail with WWF India and Bird Business with PNHS, and has won awards by UNDP, Sanctuary Asia, WWF International, and the Royal Bank of Scotland for his work. Thank you so much, Rohan, for joining us today. Over to you.
Thanks for this opportunity, Misha, and thanks for reading out the introduction, which I wrote, by the way.
Yeah.
thanks to each one of you who've joined and who have nothing better to do on a Sunday morning than to listen to my talk. Thanks a lot for being here. Whenever I'm asked to do talks, it's usually just about my work and how cartoons help in conservation communication. I thought I'd do something different, this being with eBird and Early Bird. So I chose to speak about my journey as a bird watcher and the various adventures and misadventures I've had in this 15-year-long journey. So just to familiarize you with the title, there is a term called dipping, which means to miss the birds that you are after. And I call myself the Big Dipper because my entire journey has been about dipping. So yeah. Just a disclaimer in the beginning, I'm very new to Zoom. I'm not really well acquainted with this format. So in case I fumble or make any errors or, dig my nose and scratch my hair in the middle of things, please overlook my shortcomings. All right. So as you all know, we've got 1300 species of birds in this very rich and biodiverse subcontinent. And, we've got two types of bird watchers, mainly. The ones who are really lucky and the ones who are cursed with an unending spell of bad luck and who were born jinxed, which is me. Now, birds, of course, are majestic and magnificent. Most birds are. Some are jerks. I'll tell you which ones are jerks now. So when I began birding, I was really interested in raptors. I still am. They are my among my favorite animals in the entire animal kingdom. I'm obsessed with raptors. But when I began birding, I used to go out and come back with many new species in my checklist that I had never seen before. And I would take the field guide along, and they would look very similar to the illustration in the field guide. And this is how I would identify it. It would be an osprey sometime, a changeable hawk eagle, a Jordan's baza, a rufous-bellied eagle, all in my city in Nagpur. Later, with some experience and after having my pictures reviewed, I found out that they are all oriental honey buzzards. And why is this? I later learned that the honey buzzard does something called plumage mimicry. Now, it's not a typical raptor. It feeds on honey and beehives and bee larvae. It's not a hunter like eagles. So it doesn't have the eagle's robust features or the hawk's aggressiveness. So what it does to defend itself from larger predators is it tries and looks like all these more aggressive and larger raptors. So it mimics the plumage of hawk eagles and hawks and larger eagles as well. So it's an incredible defense mechanism for the bird, but it's also a source of major embarrassment for amateur birders. And yet the honey buzzard is my favorite bird because it shares my sweet tooth. There are other birds that can hurt a birder's pride very seriously. Among them are pipits. They're very notorious. I'm just going to read out a poem that I wrote as my tribute to pipits. And this is based on real life experiences. not many things about winter mornings are tiring or insipid. Winter because a lot of pipits are migratory that visit the subcontinent. But one such thing, my friends, is having to identify a pipit. As I raise my binoculars, I see two Siamese twins. Tawny pipits, I pronounce them, but at that, my brother grins. My brother is Rohit Chakravarti, who's a chiropterologist. He studies bats, but he's also a very good bird watcher. Get some good pictures with pipit IDs, do not hurry. And I'll get the field guide out, then we'll sit and worry. I love these barren meadows, he says. They're a pipit's heaven. Out comes the field guide and the dreaded plate 97. Longbill, rosy, uplands, blights, we discuss, we compare. While Paddyfield and Richards at us from the handbook stare. Shortly, we realize that we've taken all the names and all these pale passerines look exactly the same. Compare the calls, my brother instructs. The book says cluck, cluck, cluck. Then our pipits sing clip, 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 and I utter, that's censored. Relax, relax, he reassures. There are some pointers still. The supercilium, the feet, the tail, the length of the bill. Ours have darker lows, you see, and are streaked on the flanks and the breast. This show was making me lose much hair, both on my head and my chest. To a horror, we realize, when one flashes its olive back, that the two are different species, not quite our Jill and Jack. Phew, my brother sighs, these guys are hard to distinguish. You chase the pipits, I tell him, I'd rather identify the fish. That was pipits in a nutshell. Then there are waders. I've had a terrible experience trying to get my head around identifying waders. And that's because, now, you know, in the northern latitudes of the world, waders are fairly easy to distinguish because they breed there and their breeding plumages are very distinct. There's the Dunlin, the Curlew Sandpiper, the Ruff. But when they come to India, this is what they all look like. The field guide says that waders have peculiar features that make them easy to identify, like the greater sand plover's white wing bar. The field guide does not tell you that several other features have the same, several other birds have the same peculiar features. Then there are things like the wing tip reaching the tail tip, extending slightly beyond the tail tip, legs falling short of the tail tip, legs extending slightly beyond the tail tip. Now, I don't know, to appreciate these differences, do you need a spotting scope or a microscope? Then there are very notorious birds, like, again, the sand plovers. Now, the field guide says that a good way to distinguish between these two is the color of the legs. All right, the lesser sand plover has darker legs, the greater has paler legs. But what the greater sand plover goes and does is discolor its legs in mud, all right? And the only reason I can think of is to derive some kind of sadistic pleasure out of hurting a bird watcher's pride. This is my experience with waders in one picture. I'm just going to leave you to read some of the cartoons as and when they appear. Then there are warblers, my goodness. This, I remember, is a titler's leaf warbler because I drew it. Otherwise, I won't be able to tell you which one it is. I have illustrated a short comic field guide about how to identify warblers, which I'm going to read out to you. First, note the overall size, then the preferred habitat. Listen to the call. Observe the color of the bill and the feet. Number of wing bars, very important. Note the extent of the supercilium, whether it's going beyond the eye, whether it's ending at the eye. Conclude that they all look alike. Writhe in agony. Pretend that warblers do not exist. What sunbirds instead? They're very easy to identify. Now, birding by the year has been romanticized and written about several times by you know, various British natural historians and authors and even Indian ones. And you know, there is a certain pleasure and indulgence in birding by the year, but things can go awfully wrong. Let me tell you how. Just follow the images. Mimicry, that's what a black drongo does. So if you're, especially if you're taking a group out for birding and you're relying only on your ears, the black drongo and other birds that mimic can cause major embarrassment. These are some birds I've only heard, but I've never seen them. The mountain scops owl, the forest eagle owl, the oriental scop sow. Well, one of the owls. Then I've tried and went looking for several birds that are not very easy to see, and I've had really bad luck with many of them. One is the broad-tailed grass bird, which breeds in Coorg. It's a bird of the Sholas in the Western Ghats. And my bird watcher friends told me that monsoon is a great time to go and watch the bird breeding and doing courtship displays and dances all around the grasslands. So I did go to see the broad-tailed grass bird, but what they didn't tell me was to be prepared for these creatures, leeches. Then the dusky eagle owl, a major dip. Everybody who goes to Bharatpur sees this bird. Everybody. I ask anybody and you can't miss a dusky eagle owl. But when I went to Bharatpur, it just decided not to show up. I was fortunate enough to see its poop, but not the bird. The blithe tragopan, not a very easy bird to track. But I did hear it wailing. Now the tragopan has a very typical call. It sounds like the wailing of a human child. So I heard it wailing and this is what happened. The Wayanad laughing thrush. I've made 21 trips to the Western Ghats and I still haven't seen this bird. It's again not a very difficult bird to see. Everybody sees it. I don't know what problem it has with me. This is how other birds see the collared falconet. In places like throughout the foothills of the Himalayas. I think Corbett is one of the best places to see the bird. So is Manas. And this is how I saw the collared falconet. That's it, one speck of black. Photo credit is obviously not me. But yeah, I've had some rare rays of hope, some birds I'm truly grateful to. And I'm just going to enlist some of them here. The Bugun Leo Chakla, one of the world's most rare birds, possibly. So on my first day in Eagle Nest, which was also my first day in the northeast of India, way back in 2013, we went to look for the Bugun Leo Chakla in a particular cluster of bushes. And what happened was a collared owlet came and perched right behind us and started calling. Now the collared owlet is a predator. It hunts bush birds like the Leo Chakla. And when it calls, there's a lot of chaos in these mixed flocks. And they start, flying about. So the collared owlet started calling and a pair of Bugun Leo Chaklas flew out of the bush. And ever since I owed my life to this hunter. When I landed in Guwahati the first time, I took a taxi straight to the garbage dump. Why? Because this very rare bird, the greater adjutant stork, lives there. And it's the easiest place to see the greater adjutant. And it's a feeder of carrion and garbage and offal. So particularly easy to see the bird if you visit the garbage dump. But of course, it leaves your taxi driver very perplexed. And I'm guessing even the stork. The forest owlet, again, I think among the country's rarest birds, rediscovered in 1986. And since then, it has been showing up in a lot of places other than Melghat. Melghat was where it was rediscovered by Pam Rasmussen. And in 2014, I had the privilege of observing a pair there. Although it came at a price, our car had a flat tire right when we saw the forest owlets. The chestnut back laughing thrush, which I had the pleasure of observing in Digbud. And I couldn't believe that I had the last laugh with the laughing thrushes then. Some endangered birds that have been honored enough to see. The white-bellied heron in Bhutan and the white-bellied shortwing very recently in Valparai. Taking some pot shots at me. The blood pheasant in Bhutan again, which happens to be a really majestic bird and the state bird of Sikkim. The critically endangered Bengal florican. We all know about florican courtship displays, and I think that jumpy effect is something they have on all of us bird watchers when we manage to have a sighting of this critically endangered bird. I'm just going to tell you a short story about my search for the great hornbill. Again, a very easy bird to see for most bird watchers, but one that has really pestered me for years. So the great hornbill has fascinated me for a very long time. It's been one of my favorite birds and one of the birds I've really wanted to see in my life. So my search began in 2010 in Periyar, when we could just hear the call. That's my brother again with me. We could just hear the call, which is a sharp bawk, bawk, but we couldn't see the bird. Then I went to Masinagudi, and a homestay owner claimed to know a known roost of a pair of great hornbills, and he took me there, and this is what he said. Then I went to Bhadra. I heard them again. I chased the calls frantically everywhere, but couldn't get the bird. I went back to Masinagudi again, only to hear this. Then in Dandeli, there was some hope. My companion pointed towards a pair of great hornbills, but they turned out to be Malabar pied hornbills, which can be confused in flight because they look similar. Then I went to Valparai. I met a man who called himself the Hornbill Man. And he was a guide there. And he said, there's a known roost of hornbills and I'll take you there. And there's no way you can miss this bird here. And I just followed him. And this is what happened. Please do not break your binoculars. They're very expensive in a country like ours. Then just to console myself, I trained my mind to believe that great hornbills do not exist. They are but a mere illusion. Until, insert background score of your choice, I visited Royal Manas in Bhutan on an assignment for the Wildlife Trust of India. And that's where I heard a tremendous whooshing, almost like the engine of a helicopter. And this is what I saw: a family of great hornbills, a pair of parents and a chick and a fledgling that had just come and landed very close to me. This is what a hornbill sighting does to you. And time practically stood still as I observed a family, a male, a female, and a juvenile, feeding, preening, and chattering. And then suddenly something magical happened. A fig dropped out of one of the bird's bills straight into my palm. These are some of the inferences I made having finally seen hornbills that day, that great hornbills exist. They are not illusions. They are among the most majestic, magical, and otherworldly creatures, definitely. Nature reserves the best miracles for when you're off guard and alone. Great hornbills are pretty tolerant of histrionics. And the other species of hornbills I'm yet to see will be just as memorable. This is a picture of the first time I saw great hornbills in Royal Manas. They're truly majestic, magical birds. Since then, I've managed to see a couple of other equally regal hornbills, like the rufous-necked hornbill in Eagle Nest again, the knobbed hornbill in Sulawesi in Indonesia. And they've all been, you know, very memorable sightings. I'll just speak a bit about my art and leave you to read some of my cartoons on birds. I'm a cartoonist and illustrator. Most of my work is on conservation and a lot. In fact, a majority of my work has happened around birds and bird conservation. Great Indian bustards, as we all know, are facing a really bad time in India. They're probably less than 60 birds alive in the country and in the world. And they face several threats. One of the largest threats right now is linear development. I've drawn a lot of cartoons on captive birds and how the illegal pet trade affects wild birds in India. Not all my work is gloom and doom. Some tries to demystify wildlife biology and science, such as this cartoon. It's a depiction of the great horn. A hornbill's nesting behavior in which the female locks herself and depends on the male for rearing herself and the chick. This is the process for my cartooning in short. It all begins with developing your characters out of basic shapes, and then you flesh them out, you color them, you try out different expressions by watching yourself and enacting those expressions. Then along with expressions come gestures. So it's a lot of learning to act and learning to perform and then draw it. And you know, then there are things like background design. There's a rule of thirds which applies to photography and also applies to other art forms, cartooning being no exception. Certain other rules of framing, and then what you see is the finished colored published cartoon. Other than cartoons and comic strips, I also do illustration work such as this one with done with eBird and Word Count India, which I'm sure a lot of you have already seen in merchandise and online. It was to celebrate Endemic Bird Day. So this is a collage of 26 of India's endemic birds on an outline map of India. I also do campaign mascots and mascots for various bird conservation initiatives. This is a swan goose, which is a goose found in Siberia and Central Asia. And this was a mascot for Beidehe Wetland Park in China. The Mabula ground hornbill, which is the world's largest hornbill found in South Africa. This is a campaign mascot for BirdLife International's campaign to save the ground hornbill in South Africa. I also illustrate maps of wildlife, and this particular one dealt with birds and their migration. So this was a project with BNHS in which we tried to interpret visual data about that was obtained by ringing birds, ringing and retrieving them. That speaks about where these birds were ringed and where they were retrieved, which shows where they breed and where they migrate to in a particular time of the year. So I also do several collaborations with scientists in order to popularize their work on birds and other animals. My latest book, Bird Business, which was published last year by BNHS, is a collection of 100 illustrations on bird behavior from India. These are all Indian species. And the book is about what these birds do in their lives, how they interact with their environments, how they exploit a particular food resource or an environmental resource available to them. And it's a fun, delightful way of gaining an insight into bird biology in the Indian context. And the best thing that happened during the course of this book was that before illustrating this, I thought of myself as a decent bird watcher who knew a fair bit about birds. But during the course of working on this book and researching and illustrating, I came to know that I know nothing about birds, and which is why I call myself a failed birder. These are a few places where you can read my work. In the print, I get published in 3 Indian newspapers, Sunday Midday, The Hindu, and another edition of The Hindu called Blink. I have a website, greenhumor.com. I'm on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And I've done 2 books, as Misha mentioned, Bird Business and The Great Indian Nature Tree. My first bird that I started birding with was the laughing dove. And I think it's very ironic and very symbolic that I make a living drawing cartoons and trying to make people smile. My latest was a very special sighting, the Hume's hawk owl in Mahatma Gandhi Marine National Park in the Andamans. And what made this sighting so much more memorable was that we saw the hawk owl flying above a bioluminescent sea in an evening. And you know, that nothing gets better than that. Playback is something I'm very dead against. If it's not serving a scientific purpose, if it's only facilitating a good picture or a good sighting. And this is something I've been fighting against for a long time now. And I'd just like to tell you that I've seen over 900 species of birds in the world, over 750 species of birds within the subcontinent, and all of them have been without playback. I've also been doing the daily eBird challenge for 1295 days now, unbeaten, 1296, including today. So yeah, that's about it. I thought this is a bird watcher's meet, and this cartoon would be perfect to end it with.